So welcome everyone. Apologies for the delay. As you know, these things, when they're running digitally, there's always technical issues. Of course, after all, we remember in 82, Walt Disney had terrible trouble setting up Disneyland. All sorts of things went wrong. Ah, but I know what you're thinking. John, but when Disneyland broke down, the Pirates of the Caribbean, they didn't need the tourists. Yep, that's right. There'll be plenty of Jurassic Park quotes here today. So I hope you're all ready for what I hope will be a fun and educational talk for everybody, because I know everybody loves a good dinosaur chat. So I know we're running a little behind, so we'll just get straight into it. So welcome. We're going to meet some of the new dinosaurs of Jurassic World Dominion, which is the final installment of the Jurassic World series, which is going to be out next year. So a lot of information has come out in the last few months, and collated it all together, and we're going to meet some new dinosaurs, see some old faces as well, and tell you all about what's going on without spoiling the movie itself. So first, a little bit about me. My name's Sean. I sometimes go by the name Dino Guy. I've been a dinosaur nut since I was a little kid. And of course, Jurassic Park really cemented it on that. And I think this comic book really shows my life up to now. That's me dragging my long-suffering mother as a child to every single Jurassic Park movie. And here I am now as an adult, dragging my still long-suffering mother to every single Jurassic Park movie, or should I say Jurassic World movie. She's a sci-fi fan. She doesn't mind. She likes it. So just to kind of give you a bit of an idea, so I'd be what you call like a dinosaur enthusiast, a Jurassic Park super fan. I've been doing conventions now since 2014, so a few years. So you see up on the left-hand side, there's me dressed like Robert Muldoon, being attacked by a Tegu lizard who is standing in for a velociraptor. And anywhere at all, where there's dinosaur media or skeletons or anything like that, I'll travel the world to find them. I love going to museums, talking about dinosaurs on TV, talking about Jurassic Park online, you name it. I've done it, and that's what I'm going to do for the rest of my days. So enough about me. You guys are here for the dinosaurs, so let's meet a few of them. So as some of you might know, they released a preview of Jurassic World Dominion a couple of months back. It was in IMAX cinemas. I will say that it was leaked online. I mean, it's possible to find it, but I would recommend not, because the video quality is very poor. So I would actually recommend waiting till it comes out in the cinema next year and see it in all of its big screen glory. But it was a really interesting preview in that it's kind of set eons ago in the actual time of the dinosaurs, before the Jurassic Park was built. So it's kind of like a little mini prequel, and there was loads and loads of cool dinosaurs in it, some of whom we've never actually seen before. So that's what the first half of this talk is going to be all about. So one of the first ones that we see is a dinosaur called Dreadnoughtus. That name might be familiar to some people, because at the end of the last Jurassic World movie, we saw Dr. Wu sneaking off. Remember, he stole all the embryos, so he's going to do some experiments there. But they're all labeled, and one of them was Dreadnoughtus, which is a dinosaur we haven't seen in Jurassic World before, but it has finally made its first appearance on screen. So as you can see, the picture quality on the left isn't great, but it's one of the big long-necked dinosaurs. Relative of Apatosaurus and Brachiosaurus, but a little bit bigger. So there's a good artist's take on what Dreadnoughtus looked like in real life over there on the right. Now, it was one of the biggest dinosaurs, nearly as big as Argentinosaurus, nearly as big as Puertosaurus, weighing about 60 tons. To put that in perspective, that's the weight of about 10 elephants. So Dreadnoughtus was absolutely massive. And to put it in scale, there's Dreadnoughtus size comparison to an airplane. So if anybody's been on an airplane, they'll tell you it's pretty big. And interestingly enough, the Boeing plane weighs 50 tons when there's nobody in it, and Dreadnoughtus weighs 60 tons. So he actually weighed more than an airplane. It's kind of hard to fathom how big that creature actually was. But speaking of airplanes, there was another creature that showed up in this preview. Not actually a dinosaur, but probably like a living plane itself. You might have heard of this guy, Quetzalcoatlus, which is believed to be one of the biggest creatures ever to fly. Now, it's not a dinosaur. It's actually a pterosaur, which is a type of flying reptile which happened to live at the same time as the dinosaurs. Quetzalcoatlus is believed to be one of the biggest. And here in the preview, it's shown to be a scavenger. eating the remains of food, bits and pieces that it could find. But what we do realize that Quetzalcoatlus was once thought to be just a scavenger, but now scientists feel like it was probably a hunter or an opportunist, kind of like a massive, massive stork. And to show you exactly how big Quetzalcoatlus actually was, we'll see in this image here that it was pretty darn big. That's a T-Rex it's standing next to. Quetzalcoatlus, when it walked around, was taller than a T-Rex. So we think maybe they could have acted like vultures or flying hyenas and, you know, ganged up on dinosaurs and chased them off their prey. So you see there, you've got Sherlock Holmes there. It gives us a scale for a person. And that little white guy down there, number B, that's what a velociraptor would have looked like in real life. Not as big as the movies. So if Quetzalcoatlus were around today, it would probably eat people. Let's not beat around the bush here. But back in its day, it was probably a fearsome predator attacking from the skies, probably eating all kinds of animals, even small to medium-sized dinosaurs. Anything that would be a person the size of a person or smaller was probably on the menu for this guy. So when you think back to the Cretaceous, back to North America, you had T-Rex walking around to worry about. And even when he wasn't around, you have to watch the skies because Quetzalcoatlus was on the prowl too. Which brings us on to, so a lot of people think pterosaurs are birds, but they're not. I mentioned that they're actually reptiles. What we do know now is that dinosaurs themselves are very closely related to birds. And another dinosaur that we see in our preview there on the left, he's only in a silhouette, it's hard to get good picture quality of him, is Oviraptor. Oviraptor, despite the name, is not very closely related to Velociraptor, the famous raptors from Jurassic Park. It's kind of his own thing. And in life, we can see a restoration on the right. That's an Oviraptor there. One of its relatives anyway, we know for a fact that they were feathered and they had big beaks. So they would have looked like big mad turkey creatures running around. You might remember the name Oviraptor in that it means egg teeth, which is something quite interesting. And in the preview, if you look closely, you'll see he's actually going after eggs. And in the film, he actually can be seen robbing one of the eggs because it has the name Oviraptor, which means egg teeth. It was called this because many, many years ago, when they discovered the first skeleton of Oviraptor, you see it there on the left, it was kind of it appeared to be reaching out over a nest of dinosaur eggs. And these eggs were believed to be from a different dinosaur called Protoceratops, an early ancestor of the famous Triceratops. So the scientists thought that this was a villain of the dinosaur era, and he was caught in the act trying to rob another dinosaur's egg. But it wasn't until many, many, many years later when we invented better microscopes and we were able to look inside the eggs. And we saw that, in fact, these eggs contained tiny bones of the yet-to-be-hatched dinosaurs. But they weren't Protoceratops. They were actually Oviraptor. So rather than being the villainous egg thief that we always see it portrayed as in TV, Oviraptor was actually a very kind, caring, diligent parent. In fact, quite sadly, this particular Oviraptor seems to have passed away in the noble act of defending its own eggs, its own nest. So the name Oviraptor, which has been tarnished with for over 100 years, just seems really unfair. But that's so still to this day, we are still seeing poor old Oviraptor robbing eggs. It's probably not fair, you know? But moving on, we've got Nasutoceratops. Some of you guys might remember him if you've seen that Jurassic World short film. The Battle of Big Rock. The Battle of Big Rock, by the way, was filmed right here in Ireland, down in Powers Court, not too far from where I'm presenting right now. So Nasutoceratops, this is what they look like. You can see the male in the background with his big nose horn, the mammy there as well, and their little baby as well. So we know that the horned dinosaurs, they moved in herds. So we see in Jurassic World Dominion, there's a big herd of them walk around. So we're pretty confident that as the Grant said, they do move in herds. So at a glance, you know, Nasutoceratops looks a lot like Triceratops, and they were closely related, but it's possible to tell the difference if you look really closely at the horns. Whereas Triceratops' horns were kind of straight and upward pointing, and Nasutoceratops came out the side a little bit and then pointed forward, kind of like bull horns, you know, like one of those Wild Wild West kind of steers. So in real life, it probably acted a lot like a big bull, a big cow. So they sometimes call them the cows of the Cretaceous, these these horned dinosaurs. So we're not sure what kind of a role Mesutoceratops would play in Jurassic World Dominion, but it's nice to see it back. It's a really cool, really lovely, visually striking dinosaur. It's a favorite of mine. And also joining is another plant eater who, apologies, the picture quality isn't great. This is Iguanodon. You might have heard of Iguanodon because they were a really successful dinosaur, one of the famous plant eaters, and they lived all over the world. They lived in America. They lived in Europe. They lived right here, actually. They've been found in England, so they were probably in our neck of the woods millions of years ago. So Iguanodon is what we would call a peaceful plant eater. But we say the word peaceful when we talk about dinosaurs and animals. They're peaceful to a point. They're peaceful until someone comes and annoys them. So say a predator coming. For example, we look at Iguanodon. He doesn't look like he's got much going on, but he actually had a Iguanodon had a secret weapon. And this is the fossilized, the skeleton, the hand of an Iguanodon. And if you look up there, it has a massive tum spike, like a hitchhiker's tum, but it's a spike. It could be, scientists have talked about what that big spike could be used for. And one of the more fun answers that they've come up with is that it might have used it as a weapon, as a dagger. So, you know, Iguanodon might have done well in prison. He had a built-in shank. So some scientists have said that, you know, this is like, you know, it would, if the Iguanodon could get the right angle, it could be a really, really lethal weapon, and a predator might think twice about coming near Iguanodon. But some scientists have questioned if that's really what it was used for, because you have to get in really close before you can poke someone with your tongue. And as you can see, meeting dinosaurs had big teeth, so we'd say Iguanodon probably would try to run away first, but only use its tongue spike as a weapon, maybe as a last resort. But as Iguanodon always says, talk dumb, get the thumb. That brings us on to another dinosaur that would be considered a peaceful plant eater, but is also not to be messed with. You might remember Ankylosaurus, the armored plant eater that was in the first Jurassic World movie. Now, Ankylosaurus is basically a living tank. It had armor all over its body. Even its eyelids had armor on them. So it could hunker down, close its eyes, and anything but the biggest, strongest predators would have to leave it alone. So this is the Jurassic World director, Colin Trevorrow. He's said that this is his favorite dinosaur. So you can expect to see it get some good screen time in Dominion. It's interesting that it's the director's favorite dinosaur, because you Jurassic World fans are going to remember that the last time we saw poor old Ankylosaurus, he got beaten up by the Indominus Rex. This is more to showcase just how powerful Indominus was. It wasn't really a bad thing about Ankylosaurus, because as well as having incredible armor, Ankylosaurus had a secret weapon of its own. On its tail, it had this mighty club, a big, like two basketballs stuck together, made of solid bone, and it could swing that tail around. And the scientists have done research on this, and they can tell that Ankylosaurus could swing its tail, the club, with enough force that even a mighty predator like Tyrannosaurus Rex, if it were to be on the receiving end of a good hit from an Ankylosaurus tail, the T-Rex's leg would break. And we've seen evidence of this. We've seen Tyrannosaurus Rex who have broken legs, which look like they've been hit by an impact. So they probably got too close to an Ankylosaurus. But don't feel too bad for T-Rex now, because really interestingly, we know T-Rexes were tough. In fact, we found evidence of Tyrannosaurus who've had their legs broken, but have healed, which suggests one of two things. Either the T-Rex was able to just carry on and bully smaller dinosaurs away from their food and steal their food, which would have been hard to do. Or possibly T-Rexes might have lived in family groups or prides or packs, whatever you want to call them. So it could be that a mate or family members were actually feeding the injured T-Rex until it got back to its full strength, which is a pretty interesting thought. It's kind of sweet. It's kind of cute. But at the same time, think, if they're a family, they're probably hunting together. So one T-Rex is scary enough. Imagine being hunted by a pack of 3 or 4, 5, 6 Tyrannosaurus Rex. That's a very scary thought right there. I don't think any dinosaur would be safe from that. Speaking of T-Rex, of course, it's Jurassic Park. It's Jurassic World. We know that Rexy's coming back. And we see Rexy in the preview of Jurassic World Dominion. And she looks the keen-eyed among us. We'll probably notice that there's something a little bit different about Rexy. when she was living millions of years ago before the scientists cloned her. If we look real closely on her back, she's got feathers. That's something she didn't have in the other Jurassic World movies, which offers a strange question. Before they cloned her, was Rexy actually a boy? That might sound like a strange thing for me to say, but please hear me out. Because if we think back to the first Jurassic Park movie, Dr. Wu, he said that all the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park are female. We've engineered them that way. They wanted to make sure there was no unauthorized breeding going on in Jurassic Park, so they made all the dinosaurs female to make it easier to count them. But what they did what they might have done by accident is made the dinosaurs a little bit less colorful, less flashy. And let me explain what I mean by that. Because we now know that we always thought for years that dinosaurs were related to reptiles like crocodiles, big lizards. But we now know that their closest relatives today are actually birds. And when we look at the bird kingdom, we realize something pretty interesting in that male birds, the boys, are always more colorful and more flashy than the females. Not always, but most of the time they are. So you can see there, you've got a colorful duck. That's the boy duck. The girl duck is more normal gray. And I think the best example is the peacock with his elaborate feathers, whereas the girl peacocks, the peahens as we call them, they just kind of like to do their own business. You know, typical boys trying to show off, flashy, flashy. So we think that maybe dinosaurs did similar. Maybe the boy dinosaurs had bright colors trying to show off to, you know, make them seem bigger and stronger, more pompous, more cool, you know. So a lot of scientists, we found feathers on a lot of smaller dinosaurs and relatives of Tyrannosaurus Rex as well. So we don't have any proof, solid proof yet, but some scientists do think that maybe male Tyrannosaurs would have had a bit of feather plumage, you know, for showing off, attracting mates, scaring away enemies, that kind of thing. It's an interesting thought, for sure. Which brings us on to another little guy that's shown up in the Jurassic World Dominion preview. This guy is Moros Intrepidus. Now, it's a really interesting choice of dinosaur because he's actually a very small relative of Tyrannosaurus Rex. In fact, some think that he might actually be the great-great-granddad of Tyrannosaurus Rex. So we know that the smaller Tyrannosaurs had feathers. You can see Moros has a cool little mohawk coming out of his back, and he's got some other feathers around his body. So they think T-Rex, obviously its ancestors had feathers. So either T-Rex got so big and didn't need its feathers and lost them, or maybe it kept a few. The jury's still out. We don't have any real strong evidence either way yet. So Moros is quite interesting in this preview because you can see him, he's kind of picking at the teeth of a much bigger dinosaur with sharp teeth. And we all know that sharp teeth means eats meat, which seems like a really strange thing to do. Why would you be putting your face in the mouth of a bigger dinosaur that eats meat? Was that not like a good way to become lunch? It might not be as crazy as it sounds, because in modern times we have a species of bird which has been reported to, the plover bird in Egypt, has been, there's no photos of this actually happening, but a lot of people have reported seeing it in the wild, that the plover bird has a really interesting way of getting its food. Whereas crocodiles, who should normally be avoided because you'd think they would want to eat a small bird, but the crocodile and the bird have formed this strange relationship where crocodiles use them as a cleaning service, basically. So what I mean by that is a crocodile will eat a lot of meat and it'll get meat stuck in its teeth. And what happens then is the meat will start to rot and its breath will start to smell and bugs and parasites will come and start getting into its mouth and annoying the crocodile base. And the crocodile has no hands or no tongue to kind of get rid of them. So what it does is when it needs that help, it will come up to the riverbank and open its mouth real wide. And As the story goes, these plover birds will see this and recognize an opportunity. The plover birds will go in there and start picking away at the bugs and eating the spare bits of meat that the crocodile can't get at. So basically the plover bird is a living toothbrush. The crocodile never kills the plover bird because if he did, there'd be nobody to clean his teeth. So that's the kind of relationship they've put in between Moros and this much bigger meat-eating dinosaur. So I think it's a really cool idea to look at normal modern animal behaviors and try to see maybe dinosaurs did similar. But oh my, what big teeth you have. I suppose that's the tantalizing question. Whose teeth are they? Because this guy looks like a big dude. Well, this is the new big bad dinosaur, if you want to call him that, in Jurassic World Dominion. This is a super predator. We call it Gigantosaurus from South America. Some of you might have heard of Gigantosaurus before. It was a massive predator with shark-like teeth, very similar size to Tyrannosaurus Rex. We don't believe they ever met in real life, but in the movie, they will. So is it a possible potential new king of the dinosaurs? Maybe so, maybe no. We'll look into that now, because in the movie, we'll actually see that Rexy meets this Gigantosaurus. And when two giant super predators meet, generally someone walks in and says, "Hey, partner, this town ain't big enough for the both of us." So only one thing's going to happen here. There's going to be a fight. Now, I can't tell you what's going to happen in the movie, because I don't want to spoil it for you. These things are best watched on the big screen with friends, with family, and enjoyed, bag of popcorn, that kind of stuff. No point in me telling you what happens, but based on the science and the research, I'm going to try and figure out who I think, if these two dinosaurs ever were to meet and had a battle, who would be the likely winner. So we have to look at a lot. We can't just decide, you know, I want this dinosaur doing because I think it's my favorite. We have to look at what the evidence and the science tells us. So there's a lot of stuff that we need to look at. And the first thing when anybody fights, I think the first thing we got to look at is size. So we look at their skeletons. That skeleton there on the left-hand side, that's Gigantosaurus. And over on the right, T-Rex. So looking at it from this angle, you'd say, well, wow, Gigantosaurus, he's taller than T-Rex, and he seems to be longer than T-Rex too. Looks like a bigger animal. So you might say, maybe that's advantage Gigantosaurus. And to an extent, you'd be right. But sometimes when we measure dinosaurs, especially in dinosaur books and such, we always measure them in length. They'll say, T-Rex was 12 meters, Gigantosaurus was 13 meters. So Gigantosaurus sounds bigger, right? But what a lot of people tend to overlook is we always look at dinosaurs from the side. I don't know. I think they're easier to draw that way. But if we look at dinosaurs from the front, we see a different picture altogether. We realize, yeah, T-Rex isn't quite as tall, but whoa, T-Rex is bulky. T-Rex, compared to other mean dinosaurs, was like a mountain of muscle. Like, they reckon T-Rex weighed about 8 tons, more than an elephant. Gigantosaurus, 6, maybe 7 tons, about the size of an elephant in weight. So maybe Gigantosaurus was a bit taller, so that might give him an advantage for reach. You know, he might be able to get his bites in. But T-Rex was probably had more bulk to him, more heft. So when he hit hard and could probably take a little bit more punishment too. But size isn't everything. There's a lot more that has to be taken into account when we figure out who these going to win between these dueling dinosaurs. So I would say round two, bite. The bite is king when it comes to dinosaurs. So we look at a glance, Gigantosaurus and T-Rex, they look quite similar. But when you look real close, you realize they're built differently. Gigantosaurus has these long jaws with these narrow knife-like teeth. So teeth that could slice through flesh. You know, we know this because Gigantosaurus lived alongside gigantic long-necked dinosaurs. So it needed flesh-tearing teeth because the things it was fighting were big, bulky, meaty animals. And as well, the long narrow jaw meant that Gigantosaurus could snap its jaw real fast, probably faster than a T-Rex could. However, its jaw is a little bit narrower. So some scientists did a really interesting study, which is great fun. They discovered that they looked at the giant meeting dinosaurs to see, you know, would it be like in the movies, would it be possible for these dinosaurs to eat a person whole? Gigantosaurus couldn't actually. Its throat wasn't big enough. It would have to eat us in bite-sized chunks. Whereas a T-Rex had a big throat, could swallow a person whole if it wanted to. So not that really counts. I just thought it was a fun bit of info. But when we look at T-Rex, his jaw isn't as long, probably couldn't snap as quickly as Gigantosaurus, but its jaw is stronger, reinforced. It probably had an insanely powerful bite. In fact, they've done studies to say that of all the creatures ever to walk on land, T-Rex had the strongest bite of all. And that's even reinforced in its teeth. We mentioned that Gigantosaurus has slender knife-like teeth for flesh. T-Rex's teeth were still sharp, but they're also blunt, like big railroad spikes. They're thick teeth because T-Rex lived alongside Triceratops and Kylosaurs, it had to fight the armored dinosaurs. So its teeth were designed not just to crunch through the meat, but also the bones and the armor. So if somebody gets on the receiving end of a T-Rex bite, gets a good bite in, it's probably game, set, match. It's going through everything. But again, there's a little bit more to it than just the size and the power of your bite as well. What about brains? What about agility? You know, we look at Muhammad Ali. He was the greatest boxer ever. He wasn't the biggest and the strongest, but he was really, really agile and smart. For the agility stakes, they've done studies to see which of the giant meat eaters were the more agile, faster in movement and such. And surprisingly, despite being massive, massively bulky built, T-Rex, the way its legs were designed, it could turn, it could move really well for a creature of its size. A lot more agile in these kind of scenarios than a big guy like Gigantosaurus, in fact. So between that and its bite, it was probably more like a precision fighter. It would probably duck and weave and avoid getting bit at and then try to get the killer bite in itself. That's quite interesting. And also the brains. Like T-Rex and Gigantosaurus around the same time, but T-Rex's brain was twice the size of Gigantosaurus. So that means he was smarter. Doesn't mean he was particularly clever. He's a big dinosaur, but smarter than the guy he's up against is a big thing. It means his reactions were probably faster. So between the agility and the ability to react quickly and strike back, I think that puts Tyrannosaurus at a really big advantage. So you can probably tell where I'm leaning towards in this fictional fight. I say fictional because T-Rex and Gigantosaurus, they lived at different times in different parts of the world. They wouldn't have met in real life. But if they did, I would really side with one dinosaur in particular. And I'm going to do a little wrestling style announcement here. So, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, paleontologists of all ages, here is your winner and still the king of the dinosaurs, Tyrannosaurus Rex. I just feel that between its agility, its strength of bite, and its slightly more intelligent behavior, I think T-Rex would have been a class apart from the other meat-eating dinosaurs. There's a reason why they call it the Tyrant Lizard King. It was a force to be reckoned with. But there's so much more than who would win in a fight, so much more to dinosaurs. You know, what else is new? Like, what else, what other dinosaurs? I realize we're running out of time, so I'm going to come through this nice and quickly. What else can we expect from Jurassic World Dominion? Well, for starters, there's Lystrosaurus, which is something that we weren't expecting. Is Lystrosaurus was a reptile from before the age of the dinosaurs. I think he lived about 100 million years before the age of the dinosaurs. But what's quite funny here is in this photo, why is Lystrosaurus wearing a mask? It's a joke that the team making the movie made because, see, when the coronavirus kicked in, the production of Jurassic World had to be delayed. So it was Jurassic World Dominion was the first movie in Hollywood to get put back on track once the coronavirus safeguards were put in place, you know, hand sanitizing, that kind of stuff, social distancing. So as a joke, they kind of gave the Lystrosaurus a little mask because Lystrosaurus is known as the great survivor because 250 million years ago when the Lystrosaurus lived, there was some terrible cataclysm happened to the world. Volcanoes erupting, all sorts, and the whole ecosystem went crazy. And most of the animals in the world died out. 9 out of every 10 animals died out at the time. And Lystrosaurus, they reckon, was a good burrower. So Lystrosaurus was smart. Lystrosaurus burrowed down deep, probably hibernated for a year or so, waited until all the madness passed and then came up to reclaim the world. So they were super successful animals. So it's kind of cool to see something obscure and not a dinosaur showing up in Jurassic World. I really look forward to seeing this little guy and what he's going to do in the movie. There's going to be new raptors. For sure. Great. New raptors, sorry. And so this is an interesting one in that we don't know exactly what these guys are called yet. There's a lot of conflicting information going around online. Sometimes they're being called Deinonychus, which is a close relative of Velociraptor. Sometimes they're being called the Atrociraptor, which is a made-up name, maybe for a made-up species. So we don't know exactly what they are yet, but it looks like they have a little squad going on. So they might be kind of like a rival version to Blue and her team, which is kind of cool in itself. I think that could be a really nice dynamic for a movie, kind of evil raptors, you know. Raptors have kind of gotten a good reputation now. They seem like with Blue in particular, she's one of the good guys now. So it'd be great to see raptory types going bad again, you know, and really getting amongst it and annoying people and coming after us. Like, I'm leaning towards these being the Atrociraptor made-up species, because since Jurassic Park came out, we know now that the likes of Velociraptor would have had feathers in real life. In fact, that's what a Velociraptor would actually look like in real life. They were like half the size of the ones in the movies, and we found the fossils. We know now 100% Velociraptor had feathers all over its body. So in real life, it would look like a mad chicken, a mad angry chicken with knives strapped to its feet. I think it might look a bit crazy and small, but I still wouldn't mess with one. I'd say they're real nasty little ankle biters, and they can jump and they can claw and stab and wouldn't care for hanging out with one of them. So there's Blue. This is what Blue would look like had she met her true ancestor, little guy coming at her. You know, what is this little mad thing? Why has it got so much attitude? But that was you in a past life, Blue. Don't you recognize your grandparents? So as I was saying, you know, the movie Velociraptors, they don't have feathers. But interesting enough, we've seen some leaked images of the toys that are going to come out for Jurassic World. And you'll see there's that guy, you could probably see him, he's blue and red. He's got feathers. This guy is, and if you look closely, he's a type of raptor. This one has been labeled as Pyroraptor, which is a very close relative of Velociraptor, which lived here in Europe. About the same size as Velociraptor, half the size of a person. But it's quite interesting now that they've kind of gone back and said they're trying to get with the times. They don't want to ruin the continuity by suddenly giving the Velociraptor feathers for no reason, but they're giving us dino fans a bit of a bone. You know, there's another species of raptor, this one does have feathers, so it's a real nice compromise, I think. You know, feathers for some, scaly monster beasts for others. Everybody's happy. I'm pretty cool with that. And some returning heads. Remember these knuckleheads? These guys are Allosaurus and Carnotaurus, and they are back. First, let's talk Allosaurus. He's been in Jurassic World movies before, but you can see they're going with the design very similar to what we saw in the Battle of Big Rock. This is a fully grown adult Allosaurus, a real force to be reckoned with. And what I think is a very cool little detail, which shows that Jurassic World are trying to get with the science now, is it's a small detail, but I think it's a really cool detail. We look in closely, the way its arms are positioned. Like in Jurassic Park, the dinosaurs always held their wrists down with their kind of palms flat towards their body. But we now know in real life that they actually had their palms facing inward. So they look kind of like they were scheming away. So a very small detail, but one that the scientific people, they really appreciate. So for me, I see this as an absolute win. You know, these movies don't need to be 100% scientifically accurate, but it's nice to see them trying to, you know, reach out to us and do us a little favor every now and again. It really helps the whole scientific communication element of things. And then you got Carnotaurus, this is the picture of him in Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. I love the Carnotaurus. I think it should have got more screen time because it's actually one of the most realistic and accurate looking dinosaurs in the Jurassic series ever. You know, really good attention to detail, because Carnotaurus is one of the dinosaurs whose skin we found, so we know a lot about what it looked like. And the people making Jurassic World, they really paid a lot of care and attention to try and make the Carnotaurus look as realistic as possible. So as Sherlock would say, not bad at all. Really appreciate that. Like, it's fun to use imagination, but when the science is there, you know, dinosaurs are cool anyway. Let's not fix it because it ain't broke. But you might remember this particular Carnotaurus. He's a little bit more gnarly looking. Some people have suggested that, oh, maybe he's the guy from Camp Cretaceous. Nah, it's actually the guy who showed up at the very end of Fallen Kingdom. And you can see him there eating Ludlow. He's got a nickname by the Jurassic World fans. They call him the Demon Carnotaurus, because that's a really interesting homage. Because back in 1994, they made these Jurassic Park toys, lots of toys of creatures that never were in the movies. And one of them was called nicknamed the Demon Carnotaurus, this guy on the right. So the filmmakers have recognized that, and they've kind of brought him back, and they're finally putting him in a movie, which for old school fans like me, that's just a wonderful little thing to see. Like, not only did they care about the science to an extent, but they also care about the fans and bringing back the old stuff and putting a new lease of life. I think it's wonderful to see. I said Carnotaurus is probably my favorite Jurassic World dinosaur, but Baryonyx, I must admit, is probably my least favorite. I say this because I don't think he's very realistic looking. He doesn't look like what a Baryonyx would look like. And look, if they want to make him look cooler, that's all well and good. But personally, I don't think the Baryonyx looks cooler. It looks like an alligator that half learned to walk upright. I think it's not a very good design. It actually reminds me of Dino Croc. Some of you movie connoisseurs might remember this terrible B movie from 2004, Dino Croc. Looks like Brian. Why would they take influence from Dino Croc? Dino Croc sucks. But what makes me sad is when I saw the original concept art for the Baryonyx, it was beautiful. Look, vibrant colors, long snout, lots of teeth, the big claws. The name Baryonyx means heavy claw, which is kind of weird that they gave it smaller claws in Jurassic World and less teeth. I mean, in Jurassic World, one of the big quotes is, we need more teeth. You wanted more teeth. But then with Baryonyx, they gave us less teeth and smaller claws. I don't know who asked for that, but I think somebody in the genetics lab is probably going to get fired over that one. But here's what we can see, a comparison. Some special effects artist. On the left is what we got in the movie. On the right is what we could have got. And I'll send out the link to this later. If you click on the link there, you can actually see what a realistic Baryonyx would look like in that movie. And it looks so much cooler. Like, I don't know what the movie makers were thinking, but as Drake would say, movie version, nah, real version, yeah. But just before I wrap up, I don't want to end on a negative note, but I want to end up on a positive note. Only this week, two new relatives of Baryonyx were found over in England, local boys, Ceratosuchops and Reparoventricular. So those guys were, so those guys are brand new to science. So I'm going to finish up on this slide and we'll move over the conversation to our Discord channel. But what I want to get the point across is sometimes people think surely all the dinosaurs have been found now and it's too late for anyone who wants to be a paleontologist. That's totally wrong. As these guys prove, we discover new dinosaurs all the time. They did a survey recently. We know of about 300 kinds of dinosaur, and the scientists estimate that less than 5% of every kind of dinosaur that's ever lived has been found. So there's so much left to discover. And I think you guys, the kids watching here, if you want to be the next generation of paleontologists and find the next great dinosaur, you go do that, because it's going to happen. And maybe you'll get one named after you. So that's all I have time for today. Normally we'd have a bit of a Q&A, but apologies, we ran a bit late. So there's a message down in the chat. We can take it over to the Discord. And if you want to type up a message and ask a question, anything about the movies, anything about dinosaurs, I'm game. Hey, some of the kids in the audience probably know more about dinosaurs than me, but we'll all have a chat and we'll see how it gets on. Thank you very much. And enjoy your weekend. Enjoy the rest of your Comic-Con. I appreciate every last one of you coming out. Thank you so much.